The future is looking bright, but like not in a too warm way. It's bright because we know the solutions to stop global warming in its tracks. But in order to get to the future we want, first we have to take a look at where we are right now. We're going to measure our carbon footprints. This exercise is a good way to see how our daily actions contribute to carbon emissions. But we aren't measuring to make ourselves feel guilty. We're actually measuring to see how fossil fuels are tangled up in the way our systems are structured. Looking at each category of our personal emissions is a really good way to see the bigger picture. Let me give you an example of how this works. Greenhouse gas emissions come from my furnace in the winter. I have some control over how much is released because I can adjust my thermostat to be hotter and colder. But because I rent my house from a landlord, I don't have control over the type of heating system in the house, so I can't replace it with a more efficient one like a heat pump. That's up to my landlord, not me. So I have some control, but not full control of my home heating emissions. You can see how carbon footprints reveal to us where we currently have power to make change in our lives, and also where we don't have power right now and need to claim it back. There are five categories that the calculator will use to assess your footprint. The first one is home energy, like I just talked about. This is how we heat or cool our homes. Next is daily transportation. This is just how you go places every day, for example, how you get to school or work. Number three is travel. Specifically, we look at flying because air travel is a large emitter of greenhouse gases. Number four is food. We'll think about what we eat and where we get it from. And the final category is waste. This means the amount of waste we produce and also how our waste decomposes. Keep in mind that these five categories don't encompass everything. For example, the clothing you buy matters a lot. The fashion industry is actually one of the top polluters in the world. But these categories are a good starting point to begin thinking about our emissions. So let's get going. Go to schools.projectneutral.org. You can find this link in the description below. Open the link and we can walk through the questions together. First, let's hit Start Calculator. On this page, you can see a blurb about the calculator to give you some context. Basically, it's a reminder that we each have different lifestyles, and so everyone's carbon footprint will look different. We like to say this is a no shame, no blame zone. We don't need to feel shame over our own footprints, and we won't blame others for theirs. At the bottom of the page, indicate that you are a part of a guided workshop. If you're ever doing this by yourself, check off the first option, and the calculator will provide you with some helpful hints and fun facts. First things first, indicate where you live. I live in Kitchener-Waterloo region. Next, how many people live in your home? I have two roommates, so there are three adults living in our house, and we have zero kids, so I'll check zero off here. The calculator will only compare you with other households of a similar size. For example, it wouldn't be fair to compare the emissions from a family of six with a family of two. Next, we ask about the kind of home you live in. A detached home is a freestanding house. A semi-detached home means you share one common wall with a neighbor. A townhouse means you share both walls with a neighbor. And a condo or apartment is in a large building with multiple units. I live in a townhouse with my roommates. We have three bedrooms and three stories, and I'm not entirely sure how old it is. If you don't know the age of your home, that's okay. Just take a guess. Between 30 and 80 is always a safe bet. We essentially ask all these questions to figure out the size and age of your home, because this will impact how much energy is needed to heat and cool it. Older, bigger homes tend to use more energy than newer, smaller homes. Next, let's talk transportation. I personally walk and take the bus because I don't have a car. I'm lucky because I live in a city with public transportation. If you live in a small town, it's probably a lot harder to take the bus. Here's an example of something that's outside of our immediate control. But both of my roommates have cars and drive to work. Altogether, I guess that they drive about 90 minutes a day because they both work a little further from home. Just think of what kind of car you spend the most time in, where you go, and how long it takes you to get there. Next, we're going to ask you about flying. For air travel emissions, think about whether or not you flew anywhere over the past year. I did take a flight last April, and my roommate took a flight in October, so we've taken two round-trip flights over the past year. Say, for example, that both your parents went on the same flight together, that would still count as two round-trip flights. Did you know that only 11% of people in the whole world have ever been on a plane? And North America has the highest air travel footprint of all the continents in the world. Flying seems pretty common for us here, but actually it is a privilege to be able to take a flight. Those of us who are able to fly need to be mindful about when and how much we fly. Here's an extra fun fact. The top 1% of those people who do fly are responsible for about half of all carbon pollution from air travel. Talk about frequent flyers. Next, let's take a look at food. So, how much meat do you eat weekly? I would like to become vegetarian, but I still call myself an omnivore right now. Think back to grade 3 science here. Omnivore means that you eat meat and plants. We ask about meat because meat agriculture is a high source of greenhouse gas emissions, and beef farming releases the highest emissions of all agriculture. But this doesn't mean you have to completely stop eating meat. Actually, one study found that if everyone in the highest consuming countries, like Canada, reduced how much beef they ate down to the equivalent of 1.5 burgers a week, this would stop the need for us to start any new beef farms. Next, how often do you throw out leftovers or spoiled food? I have to throw out leftovers sometimes, but I'm trying to get better. Did you know we could feed everyone in Canada for free for 5 months with all the food that we waste here? Yikes. If you do have to throw out food, it's best to compost it. Food waste matters because when food is thrown into a landfill, it doesn't decompose properly and it releases methane, a very powerful greenhouse gas. Composting food waste makes sure that it breaks down properly and is actually beneficial to the soil and environment. Composting can be difficult though. If your city doesn't have a compost system, then you could create a compost in your backyard. But if you don't have a backyard, you can't do that either. Here's another example of how some pieces of your footprint are outside of your control and part of a larger system. Lastly, we'd like to know about your waste. Do you use a garbage bin or garbage bags? If you wheel a bin to the curb for pickup, think about how big it is. If you use garbage bags like I do, how many do you fill? I fill up 2 grocery-sized bags a week. Keep in mind that if you use large black garbage bags, those are equal to 4 grocery-sized bags of garbage. Finally, let us know if you recycle. So, let's take a look at our results. Here's my carbon footprint at the top, and notice that the results are in CO2e, which is just the way of combining all the greenhouse gases as though they were carbon dioxide. Remember how we learned that there are several different greenhouse gases? Since they each have different capacities to hold heat, scientists created the unit CO2e as a way to express greenhouse gases as one unit, making them easier to measure and talk about. We can think of 1 ton of CO2e as filling 1 balloon the size of a school bus. On the dashboard, there are 3 bars. The middle is my carbon footprint, and if I scroll over the bar, I can see the breakdown of each category. The top one is the average for people with the same household size as me, and the lower bar is the top 30% of calculator users. If you scroll down, there are some example households to look at. We can see what they're doing really well at and what they need to improve on. Here's an example of a 3-adult household just like mine. You'll notice that these roommates have a much lower carbon footprint than me and my roommates. This is probably because they don't drive very much, they haven't taken a flight recently, and they're vegan. So, I hope you see what I mean about our carbon footprint showing us the bigger picture of greenhouse gases. For many of the categories, you likely felt that you had some control over your decisions, but some things needed to be changed at a higher level. Like with public transportation, the city you live in has to provide it in order for you to have the option to use it. To stay within 1.5 degrees of warming, we need to substantially reduce our household footprints here in Canada. We'll have to lower our footprints to 2.5 tons of CO2e per person per year. That means my household would need to get down to 7.5 tons. And the average Canadian's footprint right now is 14.2 tons of CO2e. That's a big reduction, but it's definitely doable. What would a 2.5 ton CO2e footprint look like? Well, an example of a country that has a very low carbon footprint right now is Indonesia. They have an average per capita footprint of 2.2 tons per year. Here are some of the reasons why their footprint is so low compared to Canada. They eat a lot less meat on average. In fact, they eat less than half the amount of meat that we eat here in Canada. They have smaller living spaces and a warmer climate. In Canada, we have very cold, long winters and generally larger homes. This means it is especially important for us to shift from gas sources to electric sources and use renewable energy sources only, like hydro, wind, and sun power. In Indonesia, they drive and fly a lot less than us. In Canada, we love to drive, and our cities are designed for driving. If we downsize our neighborhoods and make sure that essentials like grocery stores and doctors are within walking distance, we wouldn't need to rely on cars so much here in Canada. And in terms of flying, a high amount of air travel reflects the privilege Canada experiences as a high-income country. But because flying has such a high impact, it's important to be mindful of the flights we take. Getting to a 2.5 CO2e footprint will look a little different in Canada than it does in Indonesia. We have the added challenge of long cold winters and spread out cities. But Finland experiences a similar climate to Canada, yet they've already managed to reduce their average footprint down to 9.7 tons of CO2e per year, which is roughly two-thirds of Canada's average footprint. Reductions are possible. The key to making large-scale change is for lots of people to make personal change and then advocate for those changes. Governments and businesses are influenced when enough people speak out and push for change. And guess what? Making these changes can make our lives so much better. Dr. Elizabeth Sawin puts it like this. In our communities, the actions needed to prevent and prepare for climate change can give us more of the things we already want and less of the things that are hurting us. Adjusting to a low-carbon lifestyle is an amazing opportunity to improve our communities for everybody. So, let's recap today's video. We learned some of the categories that contribute to household carbon emissions. We measured our own footprints to see where we have power to make change and where we need to claim power back. We talked about what a 2.5 CO2e footprint looks like and some things Canada needs to change in order to get there. Here are some discussion questions to talk about with your class or group after this video. What was your highest category, and did it surprise you? What's one change you can make by next week that would have the highest impact on your footprint? What about if you had a full year? What are the areas in your life where climate choices are being made for you?